Okay, thank you very much, Libby, for your introduction, and I really want to thank the organizer for putting together this wonderful Anthropocene campus. And I am coming just this week from another Anthropocene event in Madison, Wisconsin, where we had our first Anthropocene Cabinet of Curiosity Slam. And I hope that I will have a chance to talk a little bit more about this later. So, in the spirit of the Anthropocene campus, our triad has different visions and opinions on the Anthropocene, but we all share the need to look at the intersections between environmental changes and social changes, and I would say social, ethnic, and also historical inequalities. This implies also to observe how the Anthropocene concept is shaped by politics of knowledge and hierarchies of expertise. So, let's go to the first slide. So, filtering the Anthropocene. How is the Anthropocene filtered look like through the simile of this ship? I don't know if you can recognize this ship. By the way, this is an image of the Titanic departing from Southampton on April 10th, 1912. Why I am using here this image? Well, because you know, the ship has been often used as a metaphor for the human condition on the planet. My colleague and friend, Sabina Holler, and we have been with her just today at the previous panel, she is working a lot about the image of Earthship as one of the metaphor for the Anthropocene. Well, I have been a little bit inspired by her, actually, and I would like to propose here another kind of ship, precisely the Titanic. Why the Titanic can be, according to me, a metaphor for the Anthropocene? Well, there are several things. First of all, there is the myth of the unsinkable ship. Then there is this embodiment of technological and scientific progress in the ship. And then there is the rhetoric, we are all on the same boat, which is the typical rhetoric of the Anthropocene. And of course, there is the tragic epilogue. As you know, the nature struck back in, on April 15, 1912, and oddly enough, through an iceberg. And you know how the ice has been so crucial in the old imagination about climate change and the Anthropocene. So the Titanic can be an anthropocentric tale. There is the technological hubris. There is the arrogant and short-sighted leadership. There are also the distracted people dancing on the boat without, you know, having any clue about what was going on. And of course, there is the poor preparation for the catastrophe. But I think that, as all the Anthropocene tales, also this one, the Titanic one, might occlude as much as it can reveal. Sure, the ship sank, but it was not the same for everybody. As you know, 75% of the people in the first class survived, and only the 25% of the people in the third class survived. So, indeed, class matters on the Titanic, and I would argue in the Anthropocene. The Titanic also gives us a chance to talk about another kind of metaphor, another ship, the lifeboat ship. You know, in 1974, Garrett Hardin published a rather disturbing, at least for many of us, article on the lifeboat ethics. And the main point was, how many people can we afford to save, no? I don't want to go into the details about this article, but I mean, what is interesting, according to me, is this naturalization of the social condition. So you happen to be in the boat, and somebody else happens to be in the sea, and then we need to decide who can be saved. But there is no discussion about why you are on the boat, actually, and somebody else is in the sea. And this can be also a problem with the Anthropocene. The naturalization of vulnerability, for instance. We have to act to, you know, to address vulnerability, but we don't ask sometimes, we don't ask why you are vulnerable and somebody else not, and so on. Well, there would be another boat, but I am not going to talk about this today. It's the bounty. I have just argued that maybe the bounty is the solution, because the point is not the sheep, it's not technology, it's not even the iceberg, poor iceberg. The point is probably the mutiny, and you need another you know, destination. And I know that you are thinking that on the Pickering Island things went pretty wrong, and I know, but it's after all, the mutiny opens the space for a possibility. Now, who knows what can happen on the island, but I don't want to talk about this. So rather, I would like to shift now to the tales of the two documentaries. 2006, two very influential documentaries were released. One is An Inconvenient Truth, and the other one is the Spike Lee When the Levees Broke. So I would like to ask you, how many of you have actually seen the Al Gore documentary? Please raise your hand. Mm-hmm. Almost everybody. Who has seen the other one, the Spike Lee movie? You know? And I am making my point here. Well, it's true that Spike Lee, the movie, is 4 hours long, which doesn't help a lot. But still, it's something. I think that it means something. So I am going to show you here a small a clip from the movie, from the first one, and then a little bit from the other one. Just a very short clip.
If you look at the 10 hottest years ever measured, they've all occurred in the last 14 years. And the hottest of all was 2005. The scientific consensus is that we are causing global warming. I am Al Gore. I used to be the next president of the United States of America. This is Patagonia, 75 years ago, and the same glacier today. This is Mount Kilimanjaro, 30 years ago, and last year. Within the decade, there will be no more snows of Kilimanjaro.
Okay. I would like now to show you a bit of the Spike Lee movie. I need to go here. Sorry. Here. So I would say that, according to me, these two movies, they speak a different language, no? On one hand, you have the Al Gore kind of narrative, and I would say that there are three main points in his narrative. So first of all, Al Gore says at a certain point that this is a moral issue, not a political one. A second point is the use of we, and you know, kind of obsessive use of we. And I always wonder who is this we, especially in Al Gore, you know, speech. Maybe it's the Americans, it's the white people, the former president of the United States, I am not sure. And the third point is cooperation. There is this, you know, this call for cooperation, which is very strong in Al Gore movie. In Spike Lee, you have a kind of different narrative. First of all, it's very clear that this is a political issue. It's not a moral issue. And being a political issue, there is no we. There is not such a thing as a we. But there is, you know, actually conflicting, I would say, us that are fighting over this issue. And so conflict is part of the way in which we act in the Anthropocene, more than cooperation. Well, there is a very stupid joke that I shouldn't say in now, but I am going to say anyway. It's, you know, so there is this joke around that according to many people, Al Gore has done to the environmentalist movement what Stalin has done with the socialist movement. I think it's a very bad joke. I shouldn't say, but you know, it's kind of fun. So today, our idea, since Amita is not here, our idea is to present mainly one of the case studies that we will work on during our course. And it's precisely New Orleans and Katrina. But we will have also another case study from India, which will be about dams and opposition to dams. Of course, Amita will be mainly in charge of that part. And we will work a lot about imaginaries and narratives on the Anthropocene. So we will work also with novels and, as you have seen, probably from our description. So let's go to the place where we want to start, which is precisely New Orleans.
Right. What we're going to do with this case study is do what Marco's just been talking about, applying different filters to the same case study and see how it looks through those different lenses. So I'm not, surprisingly, going to take a scientific point of view, but I think after that last comment, I will distance myself a little bit from Al Gore. So what I want to do is say, what were scientists thinking in the lead up to Katrina, in the bigger term picture, and in the few days immediately before Katrina, and try to convey to you, scientists that I know personally, what they were doing on the ground at that time to try to reduce the risk or limit what actually happened. So the long-term background is, in the Anthropocene, what is happening to tropical cyclones? It's actually a fairly complex picture. In fact, our best understanding now is that there will not be any more tropical cyclones. If anything, there will probably be slightly fewer tropical cyclones. Some pretty complex physics about how the atmosphere works. I won't go into that. However, the point is those cyclones we're still going to get are likely to be more intense and more damaging. Intense as measured by wind speed and intense as measured by the amount of rainfall that's going to drop out of them. So if we look at evidence for this, the best evidence we have is actually from the North Atlantic region where we have enough data to talk about this. Of course, this is the region we're talking about here, the Gulf of Mexico, New Orleans, and so on. And indeed, we find over the last 40 years, there's been a quite significant increase in the intensity of cyclones. So point number one is when scientists see something developing along the east coast of the US, out in the Atlantic, or in the Gulf of Mexico, they're concerned that on average, this could be a bigger, more intense cyclone. So that's point number one about Katrina. That was already known. But the interesting point was there's been some excellent research, mainly at the National Center for Atmospheric Research, all the way up in Boulder, Colorado, on how we can track cyclones in real time, how we can track them both in their intensity, their development, their timing, and their storm track. Katrina was a wonderful case where scientists were on top of this. They were collaborating with colleagues at Louisiana State University at Baton Rouge, just up the road from New Orleans. And they could tell within a quarter of an hour when that cyclone was going to strike. They knew precisely what it was. In fact, it had weakened somewhat into a Category 3 storm by the time it hit the coastline. But the most amazing thing to me, and I sat down with the scientists who did this, is they could track within a few miles, not within a few tens or hundreds of miles, within a few miles of where the most vicious part of that cyclone was going to hit, and within a few minutes of when it was going to hit. So the scientists were really happy. Through their lens, they had done a really good job. They'd done everything they could to minimize the risk. They warned everyone, preparations should be in place. We know this thing is coming, when and where. Now let's deal with it. Of course, what happened on the ground completely shocked a lot of people, including the scientists. And the reason for that is you need a very different lens to apply in terms of what the impacts of an extreme weather event like that are.
Yes, so actually one of the lens that, strangely enough, might be useful is history. And of course, I am an historian, so I am trying to sell my discipline, as you can imagine. But it's true. I mean, the environmental historian Craig Colton opens his book on New Orleans, writing that New Orleans lies on a subsiding deltaic flood plain on land built and sustained by Mississippi River floods. So floods and hurricanes were not strange, were kind of were the norm in the Delta, not the exception. So this picture, for instance, is from the flood in 1927, and this flood is very important in the historical memory of the city, because during that flood, in that occasion, the city council decided to break the levee and break the levee on the poor neighborhoods in the city to save the rest of the city. So this creates a very strong memory about distrust in, you know, public making decisions and, you know, even in the Corps of Engineers there. And there were also myths and legends about Katrina, if there was something like that happening also in that case. But it's not just legend. This is history. This is what they did in 1927. Then there is, this is from Betsy, another hurricane. And by the way, why all women names? Somebody should think about this.
That's,
anyway,
that's changed now.
It's changing.
They have men names.
Yeah, it's true, Ivan, for instance. Anyway, so Betsy, September 1965. And then we have Camille in 1969. And after that, I don't want to put all the pictures here, but then we have Andrew in 1992. Danny, 1997, George, 1998, then Isidore, Bill, Ivan, and so on. So the connection with history, I think it's important, it's relevant on two points. One, it's about adaptation. If you know that something is usual, is the norm, well, you need to be prepared on this. The second point is the issue of mistrust, of the issue of memory, what I said about the 1927 decision to open the dam and, you know, let the water flood the poor area of the city. But there is also something else, you know, inscribed in the history. For instance, today the Louisiana coast is so vulnerable, not just for natural reason, but it's for capitalistic reason. It's because Louisiana is becoming the big petrochemical area of all the United States. You know that in Louisiana there is this thing that has been called the Cancer Alley, and it's not precisely a very nice way to call a region, and you can guess why. And so the refinery, the petrochemical industry, has very much affected, first of all, the coastal area of Louisiana and actually also Mississippi, but also the aftermath of Katrina. Because we generally, we speak about the flood, about the hurricane, but there is something else. You need to know that New Orleans is the place of, I think, 31 superfound sites. So when the flood arrived, the issue was not just to drain the city, to recover the buildings and so on, but also to clean up what was completely messed up with this toxic contamination in the city. So history matters for this, I believe, two reasons. And then history matters, and this is what we are going to talk about in our class. Because as in the Titanic, also in New Orleans, everything is different if you can buy a ticket for the first class or you need to travel in the third class. And it's not just, and you can see the yellow part is the part in which there is more than 50% of African Americans living there. But it's not only people affected by the flood, but it's also the whole process of, you know, recovering. For instance, has been nowadays, I can tell you that while half of the white population came back to New Orleans after 3 months, less than half of the black population was able to go back to New Orleans after 1 year and a half. So this is the kind. And, you know, there was this plan that was circulating among, you know, I would say, the elite in New Orleans. And the plan has been called How to Kill a Black City. And the idea was precisely how to make the Hurricane Katrina a great opportunity to change the demography and the social landscape in the city, in what was at that time a black city. As a matter of fact, before Katrina, New Orleans as a population, I mean, the demography of the population was much with a much stronger presence of African American. 67% of African Americans before Katrina, 30-40 after Katrina. Gentrification is actually one of the phases of the Anthropocene, we might say. Finally, I would like to say just a few things about so why we are going to explore the Katrina case in our class. So first of all, because it's a story about extreme climate event and how something like that affects people in unequal ways. Then it's a story that say that environmental changes occur and intertwine with pre-existing historical inequalities. And finally, we need more knowledge. More knowledge must be mobilized than just art sciences and engineers. And it's not only, of course, historians, as I was saying, but it's generally, I would say, also activist knowledge, what Jason Corbyn has called street science. For instance, after New Orleans, there has been several laboratories run by activists and scientists together, precisely dealing with the issue of toxic contamination and the drainage of the city after the flood. So, and I am concluding here, maybe our contribution to the reflection, the Anthropocene, could be to point out that the traces of the Anthropocene should be looked, sure, in the geosphere. As you know, there is a discussion, and actually something is going on right now, in a way. But probably the traces of the Anthropocene should be looked at also in the ecologies of body, as well as in the ecologies of our narratives. And this is what we want to explore in our course.